you have this show called Hello Ladies.
Right.
And you're coming to Scandinavia with it, and it's very much about you trying to find a girlfriend.
Well, it's a
stand-up. And it's a very personal show.
It is a personal show, yeah. It's a stand-up comedy show, and it's one that I've done in America now, and I've done it in Australia, New Zealand. And it began life as me, I suppose, if you like, talking about my search for a wife, which has not gone well.
This is actually true. I mean,
this is true.
This is how your life is.
Thank you. Yes. No, yeah. I know. I'm not looking for a wife actively in the show, but it's about my sort of stories of sort of romantic misfortune mm-hmm. over the years and the various ways that I guess I thought things maybe would change once I'd been on TV and things like that.
Did it?
Since I've been on TV, I notice I get rejected by even more beautiful women. It's like, you know what I mean? Now I'm getting rejected by models, actresses. There's some beautiful women who said no to me.
Is this how it is when you get famous? That
I don't know. I've always been married. I mean, second wife, present wife, last wife. But I mean, put the two together and it's about 35 years. Trying to find a wife was never the problem. It was the other.
The other?
He didn't have any problem. He was having sex with spies.
It's a very different life, isn't it?
I mean, what do you mean? This is crazy. Yeah. I mean, I was listening to that. I couldn't believe it. Because my hero was always James Bond as a teenager. I was obsessed with James Bond. Was James Bond someone that you kind of... Was he ever in your radar?
No.
Or did it seem so absurd to you because you knew what real spies were like?
Well, James Bond is hokum. I mean,
of course.
But, you know, don't never emulate hokum.
I did, though. This was the problem. I grew up just... I was obsessed with James Bond. I was obsessed with Roger Moore as James Bond. And it's weird, isn't it? Because when you're a teenager...
And did you identify with him?
Well, I mean...
Of all the James Bonds...
We were both British. That was all we had in common. But I mean, it's funny how as time goes on, you kind of... My heroes now are... My hero is Frederick now for having... escaping assassins and having sex with spies. It's incredible.
You've been married for 40 years?
40 years.
Could you please help him? What would be your best advice? I mean,
well,
you found each other. You were like...
We were high school sweethearts.
Then it's so easy,
you know? There she was.
She took pity on you.
Maybe. She's just a tremendous gift. And, I wanted to make sure that she knew almost from the beginning how much of a gift she is. And so I just look at her and she's the most beautiful woman I know. And I love her with all my heart.
Well, you're very lucky. You're very lucky. Yeah.
You just never got that gift, didn't you?
I'm still looking for the gift.
Yeah,
I'm looking for the gift, and maybe I'll find it in Scandinavia when I do this tour.
Who knows? Maybe.
Yeah.
It's probably a teenager. So, I mean, speaking of teenagers, how do you relate to teenagers today? I mean,
you're terrified. Absolutely terrified. They don't seem to understand reason. You know what I mean? They play by their own rules. They're like crazed, you know.
Irrational.
Yeah, irrational. They're like terrifying, like zombies.
I can actually understand what you mean, because it's very hard to understand. I find it hard to amuse them or impress them.
Yes, exactly.
Very hard to sort of, because I have an interesting job, but when I come home and tell them who I met, it's like
they don't care.
They don't care.
They're not interested.
And
as
a father, you want to impress them.
Yeah, no, exactly. And I've never, and I thought, you know, having been on TV and stuff, that I would impress them. But
absolutely,
it doesn't. It makes no difference.
You've been, your career has been, you owe a lot to Ricky Gervais, as Ricky Gervais owe you.
Right.
In a way. Mm-hmm. You created The Office together.
Right.
And then The Extras and a lot of other comedy series. I wonder who, I mean, he's older than you.
Mm-hmm.
Is he a sort of father figure?
No, definitely not. I mean, on occasion, he's more like an older brother. On occasion, he has offered good advice, and I remember when I first moved to London, he was very helpful. But I feel often that I've been more, I wouldn't say a father, but like sometimes like a mother, sometimes like an overbearing mother. Yeah, I remember the first time we went to the Golden Globe ceremony. We've won two Golden Globes. No. No, you shouldn't have. They stopped. Yeah. They stopped quickly.
Yeah. I think they got it.
Yeah, they got the idea. Yeah. And but like, we went to the Golden Globes ceremony, and we'd never been anywhere. Like, it was so exciting, and it was so glamorous, and you know, and you fight hard to not be overwhelmed and enchanted by that stuff. But it is very alluring when there's movie stars and big TV stars and people. And we got picked up in a limousine. I remember from the airport, and we drove, and I'd never been in a limousine before, and it was just incredible. We were just, you know, closing and opening the windows because we could. And we get to the hotel and we check in. It's all paid for and everything. And then the next day they pick you up and you're in a tuxedo. And I bought a 200-pound tuxedo, no expense spared, for the Golden Globes. And we get in this limousine. And I remember it's amazing how quickly you acclimatized to this thing. Because I remember we got in the limousine the next day and we were like, this one's not as big as the one from yesterday. This is rubbish. We're already kind of acting like divas. And we went there and we got in the ceremony and they. The BBC had said, you're not going to win. There was no chance you're going to win. And when you look at the Finnish TV coverage of it, they called our name, amazingly. And then the camera's like looking for us, and it can't even find us. It doesn't know who we are and searching for us. And eventually, I sort of pop up, freakishly tall, and there's kind of squat, fat little Ricky, like these freaks wandering through this beautiful landscape of gorgeous people and Tom Cruise and stuff. And I remember they didn't even know who we were, so they must have assumed we were French, because Ricky's last name is French Canadian. So the announcer said, "Coming to the stage, Ricky Gervais and Stephen Merchant." Ricky got so really classy, and we got onto the stage. And I remember we were there, and I'm not joking. I remember looking out, and I remember seeing Clint Eastwood turn to someone next to him and went, "Who the fuck are they?" I remember seeing his mouth move. And in a way, that joy of that excitement of feeling like you're sort of part of something exclusive and rarefied, that's never gone away, and it still is. It's still dazzling and exciting now.
And you stand out in Hollywood because Hollywood actors are really very often
very tiny.
Very tiny.
Very tiny. Yeah.
Why is that, do you think?
I guess it's because they fit on the screen easier. You'll find mostly when I'm on TV, I'm sat down a great deal or just leaning on things. Hey, come in. And my height is very odd because it's I'm sort of too tall, really. Like, I'm 6'7", which is too big for cars, and it's too big for Hollywood, and it's sort of too big generally in life. And you can sort of see me anywhere in any crowd. I remember we were talking about trying to find girls. I was down in Trafalgar Square in London in New Year once. And I don't know if you've ever been in Trafalgar Square. I'm sure they have it in any kind of big city centre. But there's a sea of people at New Year. It's about 5 minutes to midnight. And I was stood there, and I was sort of stood, you know, kind of just checking the girls out like that, you know, just seeing what's happening. And this girl was across the way, and she sort of made her way towards me through the crowd. I thought, here we go. She's seen me on TV. I was sort of, give me some room, guys. Not to strangers, even my friends. I'm not just. And this girl comes up to me and she says, "Excuse me, are you going to be here for a while?" And I said, "Yes, I am." And she said, "Great, because my friends and I have arranged to meet back at you." In Trafalgar Square, where there's no other obvious landmarks.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, yeah. And I remember she and a bunch of her friends gathered around me about 5 minutes past midnight, and then they went off to a party and I went home. To my mouldy flat.
Have success, having a lot of success, and I'm sure you know a bit about that as well, does it change the way you work?
I think so. I think
what about money? I mean, you're
what about money? Do you need some?
Now that you mention it, can you still worry about money? Can you still be like?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, no, I always worry about money because I didn't have any when I was younger, and you know, and my father was always very careful with money, and has sort of instructed me to be the same, and so we are, you know, we're very careful, and
in what sense?
Well, you know, I mean, on a date, I don't see why I automatically should pick up the tab. I don't understand. It's just because I've made some money, I'm with a lady, you know, why? I'm just going to pay for dessert because you want a dessert. I'm not having a dessert. If you want a dessert, pay for a dessert. You know, or if you try and pay, if you've got one of those, like, two-for-one meal vouchers from the newspaper, what's wrong with that? Why isn't that attractive? That should be attractive. That should suggest that if we go further and we end up getting married, that I'm going to be a provider. I'm not going to be blowing money on booze and fast cars. I've understood why that's not seen as sexy. Being careful with money should be sexy. That's... I don't understand it. But then, you know, I'm not a woman.
You're going to Scandinavia?
That's right.
Have you been there before?
Never been there before.
When you travel like that, are you sort of a globetrotter guy, or are you
no.
are you more like a,
scared?
Is it a,
just scared?
Scared. A lot of
hassles with you. I still wear a money belt underneath my shirt when I travel, flesh coloured, so discreet.
Even to Scandinavia?
Yes, of course. I don't trust you people. I don't know you people. I don't know. You seem a nice guy, but I don't know you, really. I mean, and it's not, it's all, again, it's not very sexy when you try and buy a girl in a bar and you just have to do that.
So I didn't know who he was, but he knew who I was. And the phone rang, and his voice said, "Get the hell out of Hamburg in about 5 minutes. Don't pack, just grab a passport and go."